Okay, so welcome back to Humanistic Psychology here at the University of West Georgia. This video will be the first one in a series where we'll be looking at Rollo May's book, Psychology and the Human Dilemma. Okay, so because students are always panting and slavering for their next reading assignment like wild, unchained beasts, I have for you a reading assignment. It's right over there. So out of the book, the introduction, chapters 1, 2, 3, which are relatively quick, and then chapter 12, 8, and 13, and each one of those last three are relatively slow. So the game plan for this video is actually to get through the intro and the first two chapters because, like I said, they go by relatively quickly. All right, so let's dig in. So the introduction. Now, the first thing you have to know about Psychology and the Human Dilemma is the sense in which he's using the word dilemma, because sometimes in regular English, we use that word dilemma to refer to a situation in which we have two very unattractive alternatives to choose from. So he's not meaning the word dilemma in that sense, okay? So what he's meaning is dilemma in the sense of a set of paradoxes or contradictions that mark and run through human existence as we know it. So first point is that it's not a dilemma in the sense of some kind of negative choice or unavoidably negative choice like we commonly use that word. So that's the first thing. Now, in the introduction, Rollo May lays out a kind of critique of psychology as a whole in light of the social reality in which we live. Now, the task in this book is going to be recurrently to update his argument a little bit because he wrote it some decades ago. And so part of our work in taking it up is to update it in light of 21st century realities rather than late 20th century realities. So at any rate, his contention is that psychology, for the most part, is failing to speak to the vital issues and tensions of our time. Now, I think one way of making sense of this is to wonder a little bit about where meaning is made, for the most part, in the world in which we live. And if I had to answer that question in light of 21st century realities, I would say, well, for the most part, meaning is constructed, new meanings are made, especially by way of popular technological media. Okay, so it's, for the most part, it's not psychology or academic psychology that is generating new meanings for our world. For the most part, psychology is a relatively minor player in that process because technological media, like things happening on the internet, things happening on TV, movies, even video games, like those kinds of forces, I would say, are way more powerful than psychology is or ever has been with regard to the central dynamisms by which we make and construe the meaning of our lives. So his contention, although it was some decades ago, is that for the most part, that's what's going on. Psychology is, in a way, failing at its task, because when you think of what psychology is about, especially in the etymological sense of the word, well, really it's about the story of the soul, the human soul, the human experience in some sense. So the strange destiny into which we've entered is a project that sought historically to articulate the meaning of the human adventure, to articulate the meaning of human experience, has somehow become a relatively minor player in the ongoing construction of meaning and orientation to the world by which we navigate through our lives. And isn't that strange when you think about it? Why would the project of trying to fathom the deepest latitudes of the human soul be a relatively minor player in that process relative to TV talk shows? And, you know, probably the Kardashians have more influence on the ongoing construction of meaning than the sum total of psychological knowledge when you look at sort of the large horizon within which we live, not just the relatively narrow academic horizon, but the large horizon of the world. Okay, so that's Rollo May's basic contention. Now, the question is, how did such a thing come to pass? All right. So, and he provides a articulation of that in the introduction, at least according to his perspective. So psychology, and especially here we're talking maybe mostly about mainstream psychology, mostly has tried to reduce the essential human dilemma. Let's again remind ourselves what that word means, like the essential paradoxical tensions that run throughout human existence and consequently our lives. So it tries to reduce the essential human dilemma. In other words, the central core dynamisms of existence, it tries to reduce all of that and instead focus on solving problems. Well, here's the thing about solving problems. Like, everyone realizes in the world that it's an important part of life to solve problems when we have them. But it's not the main point of life. You getting it? Solving problems is important. It has its time and it has its place. But so too does fathoming the deepest reaches of the human soul. Like, that is important too. And for the most part, psychology has abandoned that side of its project, has focused a lot on solving problems. But the problem that has generated is that it is failing to play a vital central role in the ongoing construction of meaning as we know it. So it's able to solve problems, that's true, but there's something bigger at stake. How do we orient ourselves to life? How do we orient ourselves to the world? How do we find a deep and responsible and meaningful connection to the world in our lives as we know them? Okay, that's a much bigger province than solving a few problems along the way, which once again is important to do that. All right, so hence psychology's historical emphasis on things like quantification, in other words, construing psychological knowledge in terms of countable entities and ultimately equations, okay? Technique and science. So an overemphasis on things like quantification, technique, and science, and a gross underemphasis on things like speaking meaningfully to the essential dilemma of life. The essential set of paradoxes that ultimately run through our lives. Okay, so this emphasis has failed to embrace a bunch of dimensions of our lives. The historical dimension, for the most part, psychology is not interested in historical realities and all of that. By historical realities, I mean, you know, before, let's say, the Industrial Revolution, like the insights we can glean by a deep reading of history, literary insights. You know, here's the thing about studying history and reading literature is that sometimes people writing books can have tremendous psychological insights, like tremendously, like cutting and trenchant and wonderful and luminous insights into the nature of the human psyche. But for the most part, psychology is not interested in that. For the most part, it only very rarely wants to incorporate that. Another dimension, like the myth and symbol dimensions of human existence. Well, you can find places in psychology where that is emphasized. For instance, in the archetypal psychology of Carl Jung, you will find a big emphasis on the mythological and symbolic dimensions of human existence. But those instances are few and far between within mainstream psychology. So people like Carl Jung are relative anomalies within the history of psychology. So given that the main point of the introduction is that psychology is failing to play a vital part in the ongoing processes by which we make meaning, contrary to what we would intuitively think, right, given psychology's etymological definition of being the story of the soul in some sense, he advocates a reinvention of psychology so as to embrace these mostly neglected dimensions, like the literary dimension, like the historical dimension, and the mythological and symbolic dimensions. And the whole point is to retailor psychology to speak more forcefully to the essential human dilemma. Okay, so if you sort of follow the arc of this logic, in a way, you could say that, well, you know, in a way, all of humanistic psychology is trying to do that. Like, we've seen this theme before earlier in the semester. We saw it when we were looking at Carl Rogers. We saw another version of it when we were looking at Abraham Maslow. And now Rollo May is definitely making it a very pointed part of his critique. All right, so the task of reinventing psychology so that perhaps, who knows, like psychology might eventually, and I know this is a wild flight of imagination for you to consider this, but suppose at some point psychology were to retailor itself and become sort of more in alignment with the realities of the world that we inhabit, such that it might start to compete with the Kardashians, like at some point. And you may think, oh my God, like what a utopian fantasy that is. Well, who knows, you know, you're allowed to dream as a human being too. So maybe at some point, the story of the human soul might begin to compete with the Kardashians, as counterintuitive as that may seem. Okay, so, wow. Okay, we're already at the end of the introduction. Good thing I warned you that these first few chapters are going to go by quickly. Good thing you don't need to pop a damn Dramamine at this point in the video, because I already warned you that that was going to happen. So chapter one, similar kind of thing. It's going to be relatively quick, but some pretty cutting pointed points he's going to be making in here. So what is the human dilemma is the title of chapter one. We've already characterized a dilemma in the sense that Rollo May is talking about it in terms of the essential fundamental paradoxes that run throughout human existence. Okay, so first point, psychology has historically avoided these kinds of paradoxical dimensions of human existence. First, for the reason we've already outlined, that it's for the most part, and especially American psychology, let's say that I think European psychology is much less susceptible to this kind of critique, because European psychology has always been more inclusive of things like philosophical insights and literary insights and psychological import of the various myths that run throughout our lives, which, by the way, we still have mythology running throughout our lives, as counterintuitive as that may seem. But that's a topic for another video, probably, like how that's true. But at any rate, so psychology has historically avoided these paradoxical aspects of human existence, first because it's trying to solve problems all the damn time instead of trying to sort of broaden out our perceptual fields and invite us into greater states of self-awareness and deepen our experience of human existence. Like for the most part, that all that stuff is not coded within psychology's purview very easily, because it doesn't seem like a concrete problem to solve. And it's done that by engaging in an Occam's razor ethic. Okay, so at this point you have to remember back to test one material about what Occam's razor is about. So William of Occam, from what was it, the 14th century, I guess, mostly. I think he was born in the 13th, but who's counting? And his way of articulating this principle of Occam's razor, which is, do not multiply entities beyond necessity. And okay, why the phony English accent? Because he was English. Okay, so, all right. So what that means is, if you have competing explanations for some phenomenon, prefer the simpler one, okay? So it's a kind of ethic of simplicity. And here I'm just reminding you of stuff from test one material. So Rollo May's ways of casting this as it manifests itself within psychology is in terms of nemis simplicando. Oh my God. Rollo May knows his Latin. Rollo May has studied the classics. But in Latin, we would say nemis simplicando. Okay, so too much simplification. Overly trying to simplify the complexity of human existence. And the thing about paradoxes is they seem to make things more damn complicated. All right, so if your whole ethic, if your whole thrust in psychology is to make things seem as simple as possible, because you want to solve as many problems as possible, as quickly as possible, you want to cut out all those paradoxes because they seem to complicate psychology's project. But the problem is, the more you do that, the more you cut out what is really essential to human existence in various ways. All right, so a central dimension of the human dilemma. So when you think about the kind of paradoxes that run throughout human existence, there are any number of them. Like, for instance, we are at once individual beings and social beings. Okay, a kind of contradictory, seemingly contradictory tension. But Rollo May names the central element of the human dilemma, the central paradox of human existence, is a kind of dialectical relationship. And what a dialectical relationship is, I'll explain in a second, but let's sort of lay out the thing and then we'll break it down, as old school rappers like to say. So the dialectical relationship between subjectivity and objectivity, okay, which are always mutually and simultaneously affecting one another. Okay, so let's get back to that vocabulary word. Dialectical. Okay, so dialectical actually comes from two words in Greek, the Greek verb legein, which is the verb for reading something, and then dia comes from a word that means like a cross, basically. So it's a kind of reading across etymologically, but more directly what it is a kind of figurative conversation. So one way of thinking about what he's trying to say about subjectivity and objectivity is that when you think about the place of subjectivity and objectivity with regard to human reality, is that they're always in a kind of conversation with each other. Okay, they're and by that what we mean is they're always both already mutually affecting and shaping and influencing one another. So how you subjectively experience life is going to find its way into the objective world in various ways. Like you make a project and you can even manipulate objects by way of having a subjective thought about them. And moreover, things that happen in the objective world can very easily influence how you subjectively experience things. And if you don't believe that, try drinking a cup of coffee sometime. Because coffee has caffeine, which has a particular molecular geometry, and it also has a particular effect on your central nervous system and how you experience the world subjectively. All right, so some examples. So dialectical, all right, before we go into the examples, let's make sure you understand that word. So a dialectical relationship means a kind of relationship where two things are mutually affecting one another at the same time. In this case, subjectivity and objectivity. They're both mutually influencing one another at the same time. Incidentally, sidebar note about the vocabulary. If you talk to someone who is interested in the philosophy of Hegel or possibly Karl Marx, they use that word dialectical in a slightly different, more technical way. So if you get into a barroom conversation with people like that, just be forewarned that they have a very specific way of thinking about historical dialectic in Hegel's case, or dialectical materialism in the case of Karl Marx. And that has a very specific technical meaning. See how I'm trying to improve your life? Like I'm teaching you how to use the word dialectical and the little booby traps associated with it. Because I care about you. The tuition-paying West Georgia student, go West, go Wolves. All right, so, for instance, an example. Time has both a subjective side and an objective side. Okay, time has an objective side in the form of constructs like minutes, seconds, months, weeks, which have a very specifically and objectively determined duration. Okay, and at the same time, you can experience a minute as a long period of time. Like, it is possible to do that. Like, when I was a kid in language arts class, because I hated language arts class so damn much, I could actually, because I was an inveterate clock watcher, I would watch the clock all the time in language arts class, which for some reason was a doubly long class, longer than it was like two classes put together. And so I spent a lot of time watching the clock, and one day I noticed like how I could experience a minute as a long period of time in language arts class, because normally a minute didn't seem that long. I remember asking my dad, how long is a minute, when I was young, and he said, it's about as long as an ad on TV. And I thought, well, that's not very long, but I discovered that actually in language arts class, a minute could actually be experienced as a long period of time. So time has both a subjective side, you know, and an objective. So on the other hand, a minute could go by very quickly if you really like what you're doing. Okay, so similarly, space has both a subjective and an objective side. So let's see how this is true. So the objective side is in terms of constructs like meters and centimeters, or if you're, you know, in the SAE system, things like inches and feet, like we are in the United States. Here's the thing, like you can actually, normally you probably don't think of, let's say you're going up steps, and each step is, well, it's probably not a foot, because a foot's like that, so it's probably like 8 inches or something. Each step is like 8 inches, let's say. Normally, 8 inches of space, from an objective point of view, from a subjective point of view, you probably don't even notice it as you're going up the steps because you're young and strong and vital and all that kind of stuff. But if you have a leg injury, subjectively, 8 inches of space can be a tremendous distance for you to travel. You know, like I remember I had a hernia surgery, and that could be pretty debilitating when you have a surgery like that. And so, like, going up steps was, boy, that was a freaking adventure. You know, it was like being in the Himalayas or something. So subjectively, it was a big deal. In fact, you know, 8 inches, like if you're injured enough, your subjective experience of 8 inches, you can experience that as an impediment that you cannot get past. Okay? You know, but objectively, well, 8 inches is 8 inches. All right, so the dialectical, and this is a way of illustrating that from a phenomenological point, this is why phenomenological inquiry is so important, because, you know, it's interrogating how we subjectively experience things, which is much more toward our psychological meaning and experience, let's say, of 8 inches of space or a minute of your life. And the objective take on that, well, 8 inches is 2/3 of a foot, you know, or something. Well, wow, that's so psychologically insightful. Or a minute of time is composed of 60 seconds. Oh, I am so psychologically impressed by that. All right, so Rollo May's point, this dialectical relationship, ooh, using your new vocabulary word, once again, dialectical, a kind of reading across from the Greek, a kind of conversation when things are mutually influencing and affecting one another, the dialectical relationship between subject and object is going to be central to Rollo May's account of human freedom and human potential. All right, now here maybe it would be helpful for you to know that Rollo May is a humanistic psychologist, but he's very much existentially influenced. Okay, so the philosophy of existentialism, which has as a theme that runs through it, this conjoining of the objective side of things and the subjective side of things is characteristic of that. And so lo and behold, we find it early on in his book. Now here's some phrases he uses to get at this dialectical relationship between subject and object, like finite freedom, okay, that you're going to be free in making choices with respect to the limits that you do not choose. So finite freedom is one way of talking about this dialectic between subject and object. And world openness is another phrase he uses to get at that. But at any rate, so out of this way of talking about the central dilemma, this simultaneity of being a very subjectively experiencing being wedded to the reality of the objective world, that they're both simultaneously true, he finds two characteristic distortions or overemphases within traditional psychology. Now, one of these overemphases is going to involve the typical whipping boy for humanistic psychologists. You know, if there is a kind of villain in the story that they're creating, it would be in the form of B.F. Skinner, who is a very famous, hardcore, pure behavioral psychologist in the mid-20th century. So he is representative for Rollo May of the kind of distortion that happens when you overemphasize the objective side of the dialectic between subject and object. Like you sort of make a fetish out of objectivity and you shrink down to the point of insignificance all of our subjective lives and reality and so on. Then you end up with a caricature of the human soul, a caricature cast in terms of objectivity and quantification and all of the elements of a very objectively scientific approach to psychology. It's a caricature, it's a distortion. And then on the other side, and maybe this next one will be more surprising to you, he takes good old Carl Rogers to task for overemphasizing the subjective side of things. So, Carl Rogers, of course, is always about, and I think by this point in the semester, you're maybe too aware of this, things like how are you feeling and how are you experiencing things and all of that. So from Rollo May's point of view, real psychological insight involves dwelling at the intersection where subjectivity meets objectivity, right? So you don't exclude either, and you don't overemphasize either one at the same time. So B.F. Skinner, you end up with a caricature of psychology if you overemphasize objectivity. On the other side, you also end up with a caricature of psychology if you overemphasize subjectivity, and he takes Carl Rogers to task for that. Okay, so the real challenge of psychology is to maintain a middle way between these, so you can incorporate objectivity and incorporate subjectivity at the same time, and you're not demoting or diminishing either one too much. Okay, the ability to stay within the human dilemma without reducing it is integral to the development of psychology, to the development of human consciousness, he argues, and also to human creativity. OMG, there's that theme again. We keep seeing creativity again and again in these humanistic psychologists. Well, it's a good thing you learned in one of the earlier videos that that's a recurrent motif within humanistic psychology generally. And in fact, Rollo May wrote an entire book on the nature of creativity called The Courage to Create, which is a book I would recommend. In fact, when I teach a class on creativity, I actually include that book in the reading list. So, OMG, again, we're at the end of chapter one. Again, good thing I warned you ahead of time that these chapters were gonna go by kind of quickly. But I'm thinking I'm sort of trying to time this out. Let's see where we are. Maybe it would be better to, yeah, let's do the next two chapters in a different video. So I guess that'll be enough to introduce you a little bit to Rollo May. By the way, if you're in the morning existentialism class, morning, like we have mornings anymore in the midst of the coronavirus, we're all asynchronously communicating, so you don't have to wake up in the morning. But at any rate, what used to be the morning class, you've already looked and heard at Rollo May's thinking, so hopefully this will be already comprehensible to you. So we'll take up the next two chapters in the next video. Excuse me. At any rate, I hope you have a great day. We've got a lot of allergens here in Georgia at this point. So, I hope I don't sound too bad on the video. Anyhow, take care. Enjoy your quarantine as much as you possibly can. Stay safe. Stay healthy. Okay? And have a great day. Bye-bye.